Right, I'm Chloe, I'm chair of the AQR, and it's my job just to tell you a little bit about the genesis of the scheme, and then I'll hand over to the others to tell you about it in a bit more detail. I'm going to assume that you know what the scheme is and why it was set up, but in case you were turning up for a webinar on semiotics, which you could have learnt in the time that we were in the waiting room, then the recruiter accreditation scheme has been set up for recruiters to have a professional qualification for the responsibility and expertise that they provide within the market research chain. The scheme has been 7 years in the making. Back then, it was recognised that there had been changes in recruitment and increased bad practice had become the topic of many conversations between fieldwork agencies and research agencies. Recruiters had also voiced for many years their concern about not being involved within market research bodies, so there was clearly a gap for something. Recruiters, of course, are an integral part of the research industry and should have a qualification and status to show for it, as well as a body to go to with any issues. The scheme also enables fieldwork agencies and research agencies to work with recruiters that they know work to the high standard needed to obtain the accreditation. It's a prestigious qualification and it gives status to all parts of the industry chain, including long-awaited recognition for recruiters. It's a particularly important milestone for those working within the market research industry. Prior to this, many research recruiters had typically been seen as a relatively cottage industry, working alongside those at fieldwork and research agencies, but outside the formal framework of the industry. The benefits for those purchasing recruitment services are equally important. The training modules, which cover topics such as traditional methods, as well as new and emerging techniques, provide a sense of surety to those who rely on recruiters for quality participants. In addition to the emphasis on quality recruitment, the new accreditation system will see those who have completed the training being added to a dedicated section on the MRS website, creating a more transparent system for those wishing to engage with recruiters. This will not only provide access for research buyers, but will also be a platform for recruiters to make their services more widely known throughout the industry. The scheme recognises there are ongoing issues affecting the ability of recruiters to do their work excellently, such as reduced timescales and small budgets. And our intention is to maintain transparency and dialogue. So here we are, 7 years later, from an initial idea posited by a member of the AQR board to many, many discussions, meetings, iterations, and now, finally, and hugely to their credit, a launch. The passion and commitment from the MRS, AQR and recruiter collaborators is what's got us here today. Finally, those who are recruiting either individually or as part of larger businesses will be able to have their work formally recognised with the same parity of esteem as others who are part of the same supply chain. I'm going to hand over to Phyllis now. If you start having questions, then put them in the Q&A and we'll have some time at the end to cover some of those. But I'll hand over to Phyllis, who'll talk about why the recruiter accreditation scheme is so important to the future of research.
Thank you very, very much, Chloe. And apologies again for the technical issues. As Deborah said, a day without a technical issue is a day wasted. So that made me laugh. Anyway, my name is Phyllis McFarlane. I've been in market research for a very, very long time, probably before a lot of you were born. I used to joke that if you cut me in half, a bit like Brighton or Blackpool Rock, I would have market researcher written round me all the way around. And in fact, I'm sorry to say, it probably would say quantitative market researcher in former times, though that takes up a bit more room. But on the other hand, I was a bit bigger in former times than I am now. But I was very much a quantitative market researcher. You have to remember that in the 50s and 60s and 70s, we were all obsessed with the fact that the world was all about technical rationality and logicality. And we all believed that it wouldn't be very long before we could define a computer or a robot which could think and behave and make decisions like human beings. And so in market research, we all focused very much on quantitative. We sort of knew that qualitative was necessary, that somehow some of the answers we got in quantitative research weren't always right, and somehow the qualitatives had something that we didn't have. But they weren't backed up by science, and we thought that we'd solve all the problems and the world would be quantitative and rational in time. So qualitative was very much the Cinderella of the sector at that time. And it's only very recently that qualitative is coming into its own. And I believe that qualitative is the future of market research. And qualitative researchers and yourselves, the recruiters, will become the bells of the ball. So why have I come to believe this? Well, first of all, the science, of course, has developed. And in the last, only in the last 20 or 30 years has the new neuroscience developed, and system one and behavioral economics. And we've come to realize that human beings are very, very much more complicated than we thought at the time. And secondly, quantitative research has become to some extent discredited. We don't always get the right answers, no matter how clever we try to do that. And there's been some drifting off from the straight and narrow of doing things properly. But I really began to see the light, I think, when I was lucky enough to project manage a very large program of education and market research in Africa and China for the GFK Verein. And I realized very quickly in Africa and developing markets that A, they did need education and market research quite a lot, and B, it's particularly in qualitative market research, because I'm sorry to say this, but a lot of people who set up market research companies and agencies in Africa did it for the money rather than for the love of market research. And so they weren't always interested in training and developing people and developing the methodologies in the way in which we did in the UK, because most of the founders of market research agencies in the UK were in love with market research, if you like, rather than the money. So I learned very quickly, and I started perhaps a little bit earlier than we started this scheme, starting saying on platforms and whatever that the future of market research is qualitative. And I had a lot of clients saying to me they agreed, and we did need to do something about quality, especially in developing markets. So that's the reason how I came, if you like, to see the light that qualitative research was so important. And another big reason for all of this is that I also have believed for many decades now that the industry took a slightly wrong turning, probably in the 70s and 80s, when we didn't become a profession. We didn't go the consultancy route. And we didn't make it difficult for people to join the industry who weren't properly qualified. And I think that was a bit of a mistake that we made, but it's one that we can now begin to rectify. Because if I'm correct, and the future is moving very much towards the qualitative aspects of the agency, and we now have a scheme for recruiters, and after all, recruitment is absolutely the fundamental cornerstone of quality in qualitative research. Clients really need to listen to real people if they're going to learn about what they need to do to develop their markets and innovate. So I very, very much commend this qualification to all of you who are listening. I'd like very much to thank the team who have worked selflessly and committedly and astonishingly so. I don't know why I say that, because it is what market researchers do. They work astonishingly hard in order to meet their objectives. But really, we have worked very hard, especially the others have worked very hard to meet this, to make this qualification real. So good luck to all of you with it. What better time than now to get on with being qualified and get it behind you. So I commend that you start as soon as you can. And I would also like to throw out another challenge to poor Deborah, the excellent Deborah, that I really would like to see this qualification become global, because it's only if it's global that we'll get the real groundswell behind it of clients saying that this must be done and we have to have it, much like they did with standards in the early 80s. And I would really, really like to see the MRS lead that charge to a global qualification. So good luck to all of you. And I'll hand over now to the very excellent Deborah to tell you all about the accreditation program. Deborah.
Oh, good morning, everyone. It's good to know that I've now got an extra thing for my to-do list from Phyllis. Onto more prosaic matters about what I'm going to cover today, which is actually the steps that you need to undertake to become an accredited recruiter. So the way that we have structured the scheme is based around four key segments. The first is the actual, if you like, the legal and the compliance and the standards underpinning, which is that basically all accredited recruiters sign up to the MRS Code of Conduct and are regulated by that. So this is not only about setting standards and demonstrating competence of recruiters, but also ensuring that competence is maintained. And if not, that there is some kind of mechanism to address any issues that arise. In order to make it clear as to what the specific issues of recruitment are, we also have developed some guidance which looks at the issues that buyers of recruitment services should consider, and also the issues that the recruiters need to understand in terms of the things that they're undertaking and how it links into the MRS code and the Data Protection Act and so on. But also the aim of this is also about discretionary purchasing, and I'll talk a little bit more about that in a minute. In order to actually achieve accreditation, clearly for some people who've been working in recruitment a long time, it's very possible that you could go straight to the assessment stage. For others that are new to the sector or are interested in developing new skills, maybe are embedded in traditional recruitment techniques and have yet to have to use some of the newer techniques on social media and so on, training is required. And so in order to enable the training of recruiters, both new and old, we developed a suite of online training materials which have been available since last September when we did the webinar launch of those, and they are free for anyone to use. But then the last stage, and this is really how we've got to today's event, is about to then for those recruiters who have done the training or have got the experience to undertake an online assessment. And if they pass it, they then become recognised as an accredited recruiter and will be listed on the MRS website so that commissioners and users of research can know who is accredited, and also as a status recognition for those that have gone through the accreditation. So it is very much that kind of step-by-step process. Training with the five modules. Because of the compliance requirement, what we say with the assessment is you become an MRS member and you do the assessment. You sort of do the two side by side. Because obviously, if we were to receive a complaint about somebody who wasn't part of MRS and wasn't underpinned by the compliance arrangements that is the MRS code, there was nothing we could do about it. And then the accreditation would have less meaning. So that clearly, there needs to be that compliance link, and that's done through membership. And then we have the public register. So if you have not looked at the training materials and you're wondering what they cover, there are actually five modules. As I say, they've been available since September last year. The first is Introduction to Call, Market and Social Research. The second is Traditional Recruitment Methods. The third is New and Emerging Recruitment Techniques, which is primarily about things like social media and so on. The fourth module is Data Protection and GDPR. And the fifth is project management. In addition to that, we have a toolkit of useful recruiter information, sort of best practice guidance templates, that kind of thing, to help recruiters understand some of the more complicated issues or things that where they're more technical in nature, particularly about things like GDPR. In terms of the way that the actual training pages are structured, there are information pages with which is written text. These are accompanied by supporting webinars from leading practitioners who in effect are talking about the material, so you can listen, read, or you can do both at the same time. It depends on how you like to learn. But there are also quizzes embedded into the training materials to enable you to sort of check yourself up over time. Have you understood a page that you've just read or listened to? And then you get a couple of quiz questions, and then you can move on. So as I sort of say, there are two routes to accreditation. So if for those that are new or inexperienced recruiters, I strongly recommend you complete an online training program, which covers all the aspects of qualitative research recruitment before undertaking the assessment. This isn't a case of just sort of diving in on the assessment if you haven't had any training. Now, you may have had training by a company that you've been employed by or previously employed by, and they provide you provided quite comprehensive training. And as long as the training you've had matches the syllabus of the recruiter accreditation scheme, you may have sufficient knowledge and expertise from your previous training that you don't need to go on to the online training. And so this is where the experienced recruiters route is for those who've got all the necessary knowledge and skills to pass the assessment. They can dive into the assessment straight away. The feedback that I've had from those that have been thinking about this kind of thing is that some of the modules, they're absolutely feel very comfortable. Project management, traditional research techniques, intro to qualitative research, but things like GDPR and some of the newer techniques, they seem to be the two modules that lots of people have actually found really helpful, even experienced recruiters. So obviously what we all want you to do is to get started straight away after this webinar. So what do you have to do? So you, as I said, you can access the training materials at any time. There's you don't need to create an account to access the materials, but the advantage of creating an account on the Recruiter Accreditation Scheme website is it enables you to track your progress. And the advantage of that is, you know, if you sort of stopping and starting your way through, which is what most of us do with online training materials, it keeps track of the pages you've looked at, the quizzes you've done, and that kind of thing. For those that are interested, that have recruitment companies and are interested in getting a corporate accreditation, you have to have multiple staff will have to undertake the accreditation. Up to 50% of all recruiters within any company that offers recruitment services would need to be accredited in order for companies to become accredited as corporate recruitment under the Recruiter Accreditation Scheme. In terms of, as I say, going into the training materials itself, just you work your way through that as you wish to use it. But then you go on to the assessment. So once you think you're ready for assessment, you need to register and have an account for the assessment. And in order to do that, you also need to be an MRS member. So if you're already an MRS member, you get the assessment for free. So you can do the online assessment for the Recruiter Accreditation Scheme for free as part of your membership fee. If you're not an MRS member, then you need to become an MRS member. That creates that compliance link that I was talking about earlier. And then you gain access to the assessment, and you can do the assessment whenever you're ready. It isn't a case of you've got to create the account and then do the assessment all in one go. You can create the account and become an MRS member, and then a couple of days later when you feel a bit more relaxing, right, now I'm ready to take the examination. It's entirely up to you, but the important thing is you must have an MRS account and you must be an MRS member before you can get into the assessment. You'll receive the notification of your results very soon after completing the online assessment. And once you've successfully achieved a pass grade or above, you will automatically be recognised as an accredited recruiter, and your details will be listed on the online register of accredited recruiters. Although we will ask your permission for that, because obviously it is your personal data. So there may be one or two people who just want to almost test themselves to see whether they can pass the qualification, but are less concerned about being on the accredited recruiter list. That's entirely possible. And as I said, for those who are interested in getting corporate accreditation as well as individual accreditation, you need to ensure that 50% of your recruiters have passed the accreditation before you can achieve that. Accreditation is renewed on an annual basis, and again is dependent upon the renewal of your MRS membership on an annual basis. So the two come together. And similarly for those that are accredited companies, it is also dependent upon maintaining the 50%. After 3 years, the accreditation, you have to redo the accreditation. So that will in effect mean you have to redo the assessment. And as I say, the important thing, of course, is that the syllabus will change, the syllabus will evolve, and that's the reason for the three-year retake, particularly things like data protection, but not just data protection, also things like the emerging techniques in particular. These areas are changing all of the time, and we will update the materials, update the assessment materials to make sure that the qualification stays relevant. So going forward, I mentioned right at the beginning of my segment about the fact that there are two guidance documents that have been produced. One of them is the MRS Regulations for MRS Company Partners Qualitative Recruitment, which sets out the best practice for company partners. So these are organisations that have signed up to be corporately regulated by MRS outside of the Recruiter Accreditation Scheme. For company partners, the MRS Code of Conduct is obviously mandatory, as it is for mandatory for MRS members. And within the code, so it says quite clearly that members must take reasonable steps to ensure that others do not breach or cause a breach of the code. And so what that means is, for those of you who buy recruitment services or use recruitment services, you have already have an obligation, and you're a company partner and you're or an MRS member, you already have an obligation to ensure that others are unlikely to breach of the code. And one way of ensuring that is to use suppliers throughout your supply chain that are also regulated. So we have client-side company partners, for example, who have in place a requirement that they will only use company partner suppliers to supply research services, for example. Well, basically, recruiter accreditation scheme works in the same way, which is what we're sort of saying is that buyers should positively discriminate, directing their buying to accredited recruiters, because also that is one way of ensuring that the code and the legal requirements such as GDPR are being adhered to, or if they're not being adhered to, there is a compliance framework in place to enable steps to be taken to ensure future compliance. So within the MRS regulation for company partners, there is a rule about only using accredited recruiters unless specific and identified circumstances of geography prevent this. And what I mean by that is there are certain parts of the country where there are so few recruiters that you wouldn't be able to get anybody recruited. And the guidance gives that as a caveat. But fundamentally, the approach that we are recommending is that company partners should only buy their recruitment services from accredited recruiters. Now, clearly, that can only happen when there's a critical mass of recruiters that are accredited. And so this requirement is not being brought in, is not going to be mandatory as part of the MRS code and guidelines until January 2021. So that is my segment over, and I'm now going to pass over to Becky Pickering, who is with Acumen Fieldwork, is a member of the AQR board and has been a member of the working party responsible for the development of the scheme. And she's going to talk much more about all of the people that got us here. Over to you, Becky.
Good morning, everyone. Thanks for the introduction, Deborah. That saves me having to mention it. So, I'm Becky, work at Acumen Fieldwork, board member for the AQR and also a member of the working group for the Recruiter Accreditation Scheme. As you know, this accreditation has been a very long time coming, and there have been many, many people involved throughout the years to get us to this stage that we're at today, obviously the official launch, which is extremely exciting. The huge, huge thanks goes to the following people here. Some are still very much an active part of the scheme. Some are still a very active part of the market research industry. Some have left research altogether. Some have retired. And unfortunately, Marie Taylor is actually no longer with us. So we just wanted to say a massive thank you to all the practitioners that helped us to get to this stage today. Julie Fuller, Wendy Dern, Oliver Barker, Elaine Francis, Vicky Hallahan, Jackie McGahey, Marie Taylor, James Diggle, Deanne Gold, Francesca May, Rose Malloy, Bev Wenner, Pat McKeever, Lynn McGregor, Judy Taylor, Gail Wottingham, Rebecca Weinberg. And then the current working group are those of us that are here on this webinar this morning. So that's Deborah, Penny, Lynn, Phyllis and myself. So yeah, a huge thank you to everybody, past and present, that have been involved in this scheme. Thank you. Back to you, Deborah.
So, well, a launch wouldn't be a launch if we couldn't also recognise that some people have also done this qualification. So I'm now going to introduce you to the first four people who have already passed and are now officially recognised as accredited recruiters. So here is the class of 2020. We have Lynn Chapman, Penny Steele, Becky Pickering, who we've just heard from, and also Deanne Gold. So congratulations to all four of you. You are the first people to take the accreditation and to be recognised. They are listed on the MRS website. And I would hope that in the very near future, they will be joined by many of you that are on this call today. To give you an idea of what awaits you with the assessment, we've got Penny Steele, who's going to talk now about what it was like to do the assessment and to give you a few hints and tips if you're thinking about doing it yourself.
Hi, good morning, everybody. As Deborah said, I am a member of the Working Party, Chair of IQCS and MD of Steele Fieldworks. And that photograph is about 15 years old, so I do look very young in that one. Next slide, please. So as a member of the Working Party, I undertook the assessment. No pressure, but I thankfully passed. I've been working in qualitative recruitment all my working life for over 35 years. And if, like me, you've been in the game a long time, my advice is please don't assume you know it all. As Deborah said, there's five detailed modules with the YouTube videos and quiz questions after each section to help you. I suggest you really do take your time, read all the modules through carefully over a number of weeks or days, depending on how much time you have. Listen to the videos and practice the quiz questions a few times. Revisit modules that you might find more challenging. I know that I had to. Some of them are because of the experience, but you've got your GDPR. There's a lot of different modules. Even though I've been involved from the start and wrote or inputted into many of the modules, I genuinely had to revise. I couldn't just take it as read. The new areas that I found challenging were obviously the data protection, GDPR, and the new and emerging techniques. Next slide, please. So you have 1 hour to take the assessment, which in my opinion is enough time to answer the 40 multiple choice questions. But do take your time and read the questions carefully, as you really don't want to drop a point by misreading a question. Personally, I find I speed read multiple choice questions, so just take your time. Overall, you are asked 8 questions from each of the 5 modules, but they come in a random order. So 1 minute you could be answering a question on GDPR, and then that could be followed on traditional methods. So it's all random. At the end, you are given the opportunity to go back and review all the questions and change your answers if you wish before you submit. Within the hour, I had enough time to do so, and it was extremely useful as I went back and reread all the questions and even changed my mind and changed a couple of the answers. Once you submit your final answers, well, you are automatically sent your score and your grade, so you know then and there. So all I could say is it's hugely worthwhile. Good luck to everybody. Next slide, I'm going to pass you over to my colleague on the Working Party, Lynn Chapman. Thank you.
Hello, everybody. Right, well, my name's Lynn Chapman, and I've been a recruiter for over 35 years, and I have the honour of being the UK's first MRS AQR, whichever way you put it, accredited recruiter. Obviously, Penny's laid out how it all takes place, but how did I get where I got to? So on July the 19th, 2014, I attended the Weird and Wonderful World of Field conference hosted by Acumen, at which Julie Fuller spoke about her views on the need for some sort of training for recruiters. I have to admit at the outset, I was wary and cynical, as it hadn't been that long since our industry was threatened with the idea of a centralised database for recruitment, which some of you may remember, thereby effectively rendering our services redundant. To fight that, I set up FAIR, Freelance and Independent Recruiters, attended numerous meetings, and eventually the idea was abandoned. So I saw this initiative as possibly another attack on recruiters, and in order to ensure fair treatment for us, I managed to get myself on the working party and was asked to do a survey of views from the industry, which led to the consultation meeting many of you will have attended in January 2015. At that time I wrote, "My own feeling is that what's being proposed is not what it's about. What it is about is partly recognition, or the lack of it, of recruiters' important and invaluable contribution to the process, and partly, mainly, about the relationship between recruiters, fieldwork managers and clients, and getting everyone correctly managing expectations, which most definitely is not happening." So fast forward 6 years and 2 days, and here we are launching the Recruiter Accreditation Scheme. In those intervening years, things have changed, and so have my views. I found studying for the RAS assessment to be challenging, stimulating and vital in making me more aware of the changing needs of our market. I found the combination of my own skills and experience of 35 years as a recruiter, coupled with some new knowledge, gave a huge boost to my self-confidence. I approached the taking of the exam with not a little trepidation. What if I failed and made a total idiot of myself? I found the system allowed plenty of time. As Penny said, you have 1 hour in which to complete 40 multiple choice questions. You do need to be very careful in reading the questions slowly and deliberately, as some of them are worded slightly trickily, and some of them made me question my own understanding. It took me about 20 minutes to go through them all, which allowed plenty of time to go back to the beginning and recheck my answers. And there was one particular one that I changed 4 or 5 times. I still don't know if I got it right or not, as the system only tells you how many you got incorrect, not what those questions were. The sense of relief and, yes, elation when the score immediately popped up on the PC screen, telling me that not only had I passed, but I'd been awarded a distinction, was strong. I hadn't made an idiot of myself, and even at my advanced age, I could still get an ology. Apologies to anyone young enough not to understand that reference. So I hope that in the future, the Recruiter Accreditation Scheme will definitely enhance and highlight recruiters' important and invaluable contribution to the process. And I'll now pass back to Chloe, who's going to deal with any questions and answers that we have.
Fantastic. Thank you, Lynn, and thank you to everybody else. So we've had a couple of questions through on the Q&A so far, and in fact, a couple have been answered live while we've been listening. So do check in to see what you might learn from those. But Deborah, there are a couple here about whether you need to be accredited if you are a freelance researcher, or indeed if you work for the fieldwork arm of a company, whether that part of the business needs to be accredited or the whole business. So I wonder if you could reflect on that for us.
Yeah, I mean, I think if you're a freelance recruiter, I would say that having the status of being an accredited recruiter will be a real benefit to your freelance business in terms of just giving you that extra recognition on your CV and your sort of on your business card and all these kinds of things. Oh, business card like ages me a bit, doesn't it? But so I would say that I would recommend if you are a freelancer that you do that. In terms of if you work for organisations that are already accredited, or if you basically work largely for just one organisation that also is accredited, you could count towards their 50% as well. So it does also mean it has two benefits. You get the individual recognition as an accredited recruiter, but also you could be contributing to the company's 50% to enable it to become accredited as an accredited company.
And presumably, if you are a company that hires freelance recruiters, you are in a good position to ask your freelance recruiters to take the assessment,
yeah,
because it, you know, proves their commitment and knowledge of the industry and etc. So that would be, you know, a conversation that you would have with your freelance recruiters.
Absolutely. And kind of going back to that point about, you have, there's this code obligation to basically make sure that nothing goes wrong in the supply chain. You know, that's kind of has always been a code obligation. And using accredited recruiters in the same way as using an MRS member or whatever, it's part of that kind of recognition of competence, but also that the link is there to the standards and the code.
Okay, just one of the questions came through around, if you are a company partner, do you also need to be an individual member in order to undertake the assessment? I'm going to assume the answer is yes, but will
yes. You're very good on the answer is yes, you're right there, because also the individual recruiter accreditation is an individual recognition. It's a bit like doing the advanced certificate or the MRS diploma. Those qualifications sit with the individual, irrespective of whether a company is a company partner or not. So you do still need to have that link.
And just to clarify, if recruiters work within a company, one person doesn't take it for the whole company.
No.
50% of yes. recruiters yeah. in order to then be an accredited company or team within a larger organisation that handles the fieldwork specifically.
Yeah, we don't want somebody sort of becoming the responder for the recruiter accreditation qualification. Absolutely, no, it would be the individuals within it, yeah.
One of the questions that you already answered was around, if you don't pass, can you retake? And your answer was, yes, you can. There is a small additional fee for an additional assessment, but you can. There was a comment here that, are you told which questions you got wrong the first time round so that you can improve and regain knowledge before you retake?
The answer to that is no, you don't. As Penny indicated, we have a large question bank from which each of the assessments, multiple choice questions are drawn from. So every single assessment is unique because it will be a random 40 questions drawn from the multiple choice bank. So the likelihood that you might get a repeat question, you might get one or two, you certainly will get some that are probably repeats, but you will get some that you won't have seen before if you are doing a reassessment. That's the first thing. Also, we need to protect the integrity of the qualification as well, which is that in the same way that we don't issue examination papers for our other exams, except for we have certain ones that can be used for, you know, things like studying and so on and to prepare for exam, in the same way we don't issue the question and answers that you got wrong, because otherwise it means that the people will become aware of the questions that are going to be asked and what the correct answer is, and that would undermine the integrity of the qualification. But what I will say is that all of the quizzes that are on the recruiter accreditation scheme, they are of a similar nature to the sorts of things that you would get in the assessment. So that is a really good way of kind of getting your idea about the sorts of things that you might be asked.
Okay, and can you just clarify the costs for us quickly? So there's been a question about the overall cost to recruiters, and I suppose that needs to include having the MRS membership, but is there a straightforward answer to that question?
It's the membership fee, it's £158. And that will include, you'll get all the benefits of MRS membership. So you get things like a magazine, all those sorts of things, and you get access to the assessment. And so if you pass it, you then also become accredited. It's just the same fee.
So the only additional fee is if you wish to retake, because...
Yeah, you've passed. If you failed, yeah.
Yeah, okay. How are you measuring the 50% for corporate accreditation? I imagine that's quite a tricky thing to do, but I just wondered what your process is for that.
I think in many ways, a lot of this is about as we go forward, certain things, systems will evolve. But what we've discussed internally is that companies that are accredited would need to make a declaration of who their recruiters are that are linked to them, so that, and to demonstrate that they meet the 50%. So it would be just like an annual declaration. So when that is renewed as a corporate accreditation, the corporate statement of here are our 50% accredited recruiters is part of that.
Okay. And are the assessment modules in any other languages at the moment? I know that Phyllis mentioned, could this be a global initiative? I'm assuming that might be something that comes further down the line, but may not be something available just yet.
We wanted to get it done in the English language first, and I'm ashamed to say it has been 7 years in the making. So, I actually think that there is once you've got something created, of course, translation is a relatively straightforward next step of, with the investment, obviously. But so I think that it certainly could be something we could consider, and I could see this potentially working in sort of, you know, Spanish, French, things like that. And I do know that some of the other association leaders that I speak to have a real interest in how successful this scheme is, because they are interested in rolling out something similar. And so from our side of things, we would rather have a global scheme as well. So although I joke that Phyllis added something to my to-do list, it is kind of on my to-do list already.
Is there an official logo that if people have passed, they can use on their marketing materials and emails?
Yes, there is. There is. And it will be hopefully going up on the website and be zipping its way to Penny and to Lynn and to Becky and to Deanne today. So you will start to see it. I think it looks good. It recognises both MRS and AQR, and it shows you're an accredited recruiter or an accredited recruiter company.
Okay, we've just got a couple of minutes left, but I think this is a broader question that's interesting and might widen the conversation out to some of the others here, which is whether the MRS or indeed the AQR is doing anything to encourage new entrants to the field. So I suppose with the idea that then this is a professional qualification, the ability to widen the pool, essentially, of recruiters. And I just wondered what your thoughts were on that, or indeed any of the others on the call.
From an MRS perspective, we definitely want to encourage more people into the profession. Interestingly, since I've been on this journey, and it has been a long journey, I have had people contact me saying I'm new to the sector and I'm really interested in the training materials and the qualifications. So for those that have come in, it is recognised as a really good way of getting that understanding. But also, I think as the point that Phyllis raised earlier, you know, qualitative is growing. Although with COVID, you know, let's put that to one side in terms of how it's changed this, how things have changed this year. But fundamentally, qualitative is growing. And although the makeup of those that provide recruitment services is changing and evolving as the sector has changed, I still see that there's a future for it. But I would be interested to know what others think of this.
Go on then.
I was only going to say, I've taken somebody on to work with me who's got no experience of recruitment, and she's working her way through the materials with a view hopefully to qualifying at the end, and she's finding it really helpful. And it's good because, I mean, it's a bit like teaching someone to drive. You know you can do it, but telling somebody else how to do it is not always the easiest thing to do. So to have it all in one place is very helpful.
And sometimes also over the years you get some participants who've taken part in actual research themselves, and they've rung up the company and said, well, how do I get trained? You know, they can see another avenue. And I think probably, you know, with COVID, a lot of people might be thinking from other industries of different avenues of revenue. So it is a good thing that we could always previously, I would have to say, well, you have to make sure you go to a company that is training in qualitative, but we can point them directly at the MRS AQR initiative, which is a basis for them to start at least. So there could be an opportunity. Yeah. Or quantitative, wanting to transfer skills, quantitative interviewers, potentially.
Yeah, absolutely. And Becky?
And I think also from another field point of view is that if you're having conversations with potential new recruiters, as Penny and Lynn have just mentioned, to obviously encourage that, you know, people review their scheme. There's also quite a lot of university roadshows and things like that that across the MRS and the AQR is offered. So I think promoting it through there as well and just trying to encourage people that might want to take recruitment as a job, you know, to look into it and to uptake it there.
Brilliant. Well, let's hope this augurs in a swathe of new entrants to a brilliant, vital part of our industry. We're out of time, and I'm conscious that we have asked you all to stay for longer. So thank you all for sticking with us. There are some questions that we haven't quite got to, but many of them I'm sure Deborah will be able to answer swiftly if you will make a note of what we haven't got to. And if you want to get in touch directly, then do. Deborah, final words from you, and then it's off for the rest of our days.
Well, first off, I would like to thank everyone for taking the time to join today's webinar, not only in terms of the delegates, but also the speakers today. From an MRS perspective, this project has been a sort of cherished project that has taken probably longer than we would have hoped. But we remain very committed to it, and we really do hope it's going to be a success. All of the elements are there for success, which is that there are dedicated people who've produced excellent materials to create an accreditation that should be really beneficial for the future of research. But I will answer all the questions that I didn't get to at some point today. And I'd just like to also thank the AQR as well for being the best partners in this project, because without the AQR input, we would never have got where we are today either. It has been very much partnership working, and I think it is the strength of the relationship that we have between the two associations as to why we're here today. Thanks, everyone.
Thank you. Bye.